of our eyes. And so here are just some brief words before I hand it over to Lydia Mansour, who's moderating the first panel. Cruising utopia as if we were cruising the transgressions of our youth, the split selves that make us bi and multicultural, multilingual, immigrant and exiled, and the children of inheritors of diasporas that rage through and across earth and oceans. These selves find themselves in our books, stories, poems, plays, films, and hybrid tomes, indebted to the exploration of aesthetic, cultural, faith, gender, economic, and class differences, as well as those along and across constructed lines of race, quote, determined by neoliberal policies, first world to so-called third world. In these utopic lenses that almost always reflect its opposite, dystopia, we construct new selves that practice decolonial love, in the hope that by so doing, equitable coexistence will be possible with our fellow humans on this planet. Raging desire fuels us in the search for new stories that will spark our imaginations and those of our emancipated spectators and readers. This search, this journey through our diasporic imaginations is the core of our travels today here in Baton Rouge and on HowlRound in the virtual space. But this story, this journey has been with us for years and will continue past this day. For now, the utopias sit on the landscape of our dreams, acted on our stages yet to be written, ghosted by the past, in the palaces of our expansive and gorgeous imaginations. The first panel today is Caribbean Diasporas Tracing Interconnections Through the Archive, Theater, Performance, and Ritual. It's moderated by Lydia Mansour of the University of Miami. I hand the floor to her, and I welcome you all today, which I know is going to be a long day, and I'll keep checking in with you and saying hello. Welcome.
Thank you very much, and good morning. It's always hard to follow Caridad on the podium. But at any rate, this first panel today is looking at how art is marked by diaspora in its dramaturgy, affective practice, and emotive patina. What kinds of stories are generated in diasporas? How do diasporas retrace history in theater and performance? And we're going to be, the panelists today are going to be looking at a series of different cultural productions, and at the end we're going to have two very short performances, one by artist Margaret Kemp, and then at the very end by Omni, Zona, Franca from Cuba. So the first speaker today is Solimar Otero, who this audience, I guess, needs no introduction. She's associate professor in the Department of English and a folklorist here at LSU. Her research centers on gender, sexuality, Afro-Caribbean spirituality, and Yoruba traditional religion in folklore, literature, and ethnography. She's the author of Afro-Cuban Diasporas in the Atlantic World, and she's also the co-editor of Jamoja, Gender, Sexuality, and Creativity in Latino, and Afro-Atlantic Diasporas. Her presentation today is titled Se Van Los Seres, Espiritismo and Ritualized History in the Afro-Latino Diasporic Imagination.
Welcome, Solimar.
Thanks to Caridad and to Lillian for having me here today and inviting me to be part of this panel. It's pretty exciting. And so I'm just going to set up my PowerPoint. Could you like maximize it so it's I have just a little context for what I'm going to be talking about today. I'm going to be talking about some field work I did last year in Cuba, where I've been doing field work for over 15 years with this particular community. Full disclosure, some of the people you'll be seeing, some of the spirit mediums and practitioners are actually my aunts and my uncles and people I'm related to. So this project is very personal. And just quickly, Espiritismo is a Creolized religion that has roots in Europe, the Americas, South America, and since the 19th century has been changing in many different manifestations. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay. I want to start with a quote from Tai Ramon Ochoa's book, Society of the Dead, that deals with Apollo religions. And he says this about Espiritismo. Espiritistas are important mediators of the dead, practitioners of Palo and Ocha Santo. Importantly, during the masses, Espiritistas help the living engage these dead through a complex theater of possession, often involving the experience of Congo dead, usually runaway slaves. Ochoa's comments on the important work that Espiritistas do in the ethno-historical theater of possession, especially in terms of the representation of the legacy of race and slavery in Cuba, puts the ritual performances of Misa Espirituales in a temporally heightened, politicized, and conjunctural context. The emergence of several conjunctural moments in ritual storytelling and talk with my interlocutors in Havana were manifested through what I call a performative interorality. And when I'm thinking about interorality, it's a lot like intertextuality, but in this case where you have these dense oral traditions where people interlayering stories within a ritual. And I can talk more about that later. Discussions about the meaning of gender, race, and sexuality in stories told and rituals performed involved a co-exploration into the meaning of embodiment and the construction of the self that is intertwined in layered oral performances. In this regard, Afro-Cuban religions are intersectional in regards to the understanding of the self as a multi-layered being that is embedded in multiple social registers and hierarchies of power. For vernacular Cuban religious communities, this intersectionality also implicates the self in a range of spiritual realms and relationships that are deeply embroiled in various metaphysical planes. In other words, the attitudes towards what constitutes the self as being and becoming are in constant ontological negotiation because of the range of performative selves that people invoke in the cultural, social, and spiritual worlds they inhabit. And just to give a little bit of historical context, Harold Roman's work on Republican Espiritistas in Cuba in 1901, he talks about the mestizo logic of spirits and workers. And he looks at newspaper articles and legal cases, and he thinks about this point in time in Cuba where Espiritismo is developing some kind of a transcultural logic even in the public sphere. And within that, Espiritismo, because of its basis on a lot of the work that Alan Kardec and other spiritists did, has conflicting modernities and class associations with them. So it is definitely within itself a very layered, has layered history, and it's a layered practice. So during my visit to Cuba last May, I wanted to point it. That's what I want to do. Okay. During my mediums, Tomás Spegler, Mercedes Zamora Albuquerque, José Díaz Casada, Sonia Bustamante, Maximil Bustamante, before misas in Spegler's residence in Havana, Cuba. A bóveda. It was set up with colorful flowers, glasses of fresh water for spirits, rosaries, candles, tobacco, perfume, and prayer books for the ancestors and spirit guides who were coming to see and visit. A bowl full of water with flower petals was placed at the foot of the table for cleansing before the start of the ceremony. The masses were said in honor of the dead of the family of some of the participants, as well as a later misa to coronar a medium. Those who had immediate ties to the dead were given a clear glass of water to place under their chairs. The figure of an Indian spirit held two rosaries at the head of the bóveda, a symbol that reflects how Amerindian spirits are represented in Afro-Atlantic spiritual work from New Orleans to Brazil and in Cuba. After an opening round of prayers and songs, the spirits who came to give counsel included a range of beings: a departed grandmother, an Afro-Cuban palero palera, a Spanish gitana, a monja, a Native American, and the spirit guides associated with the orishas Elegua, and the Catholic saint San Lázaro, and the orisha, Lukumi orisha Babaluaye. The mediums engaged in code switching, amalgamation, and cross-referencing between different religious traditions, nationalities, and ethnicities in co-constructing the life histories of the spirit guides they saw in the Misa. Some of the spirits themselves were described as having multiple valences in terms of sources of spiritual power, as having both Yoruba and Congo ritual implements in their spirit world to work with, and the divergent, conflated, and conflicted discourses of these many voices illustrate how the performative expression of the idea of transculturation creates an opportunity for the study of these moments in their most messy, conflicted, and interesting sense. I'm going to read a little bit about this inner orality and how people bring together these voices. And how many people here understand Spanish? Everybody? Almost? Okay. I'm going to read it in Spanish then, okay? Oh, no? Okay. So maybe I'll do it in English then. But you'll lose the flavor. Now, so this is Sonia Bustamonte. She says, now I see after we just sang, Los Clavelitos, which is a song to bring down a gypsy spirit, a gypsy's tendency with pink polka-dotted skirt of many colors, with large hoop earrings. She does not play the castanets. But I see her circling you with that full, ruffled, polka-dotted skirt. That gypsy has her own tendency with olla, with centella. And then Jose Diaz Casada, another medium, interrupts and he adds, and whereby that spirit that you see as joyous, I see as well she had a double, like a nun spirit. That gypsy spirit has a spirit double that is a nun. A nun that I'm receiving as wearing brown with a white hood, as if she's a missionary, one of the Sisters of Mercy, dedicated to helping the sick, doing good works. I lost my place. So the Gitana spirit guide that is described in both the past and present tenses here is uniting the narrative memory of her living days with the moment of the Misa in many different ways here. And here I want to go through some of the slides of those images that we saw. So in that conflation, we see that we have the Gitana spirit being associated with the monja, as well as being, there was a place where she's associated with olla, and then also associated with centella and doki. So here you have Yorba, Congo, Spanish, and different traditions coming together in a complex interlayering. So Elizabeth Paris sees the participants in a Misa as living bóvedas, living spirit tables, that reflect the idea of the self as individual rather than unitary for participants. I would move that these suggestions say that the self in Espiritismo is conceived as always becoming in multiple ways and attached to diverse dimensions of seen and unseen worlds in moments that challenge the present in layered conjunctures. The difficulties, tensions, and unresolved representations of race, ethnicity, religious difference, and as well as sexuality and gender in the Misa direct us towards contemporary issues in human society that also require special attention. And I'm very influential in how I'm looking at this work, and the other work I'm doing is Ramon Rivera Cervera's analysis of intralatinidad and the frictive moments of communities of affect. And I really like how he talks about utopian performatives and how, and for the Misa, I really see there's a similarity in terms of moments of spiritual unity that are fraught with racial, ethnic, sexual, and class-based tensions that underlie the idea of cubanidad here. So he has a quote that I love, and he says here, and this is from his latest book, quote, moments where the aesthetic event becomes temporarily a felt materiality that instantiates the imaginable into the possible. And here we have a moment where you have the spirit guides with different valences and constellations coming together and breaking into the phenomenological realm, either through cohabitation, which is a word I prefer than possession, because I feel like it's kind of this embodied experience where people are cohabiting, and having that represent a lot of differences and conflicts that are not only now, but also has to deal with historical, racially encoded issues. So here in the Spanish Gitana, the group, I wanted to say that the Gitana in itself is a racialized and sexualized subject, right? The Rom people have been used and represented in multiple ways, and we need to see that as also racially coded and tropicalized in specific ways. And I didn't have time, but in the transcript she was also related to La Candelaria, the Virgen de la Candelaria, from Tenerife, who's called La Morenita, and she actually appeared before the Castilians came to Tenerife, and she's been combined with the indigenous religions there. And she represents another kind of fierce black Madonna, and so there's a really interesting kind of connections there with these different, I didn't have time to talk about some of the other conflations, but a lot of these black Madonnas have a lot of these kind of sharing the spiritual work. So as Roman uncovers again for the 19th and 20th century in Cuba, quote, not only do African orishas masquerade as Catholic saints, but seemingly European spirits also camouflage their hybridity in a variety of guises, end of quote. So the transcultural merging and tensions represented by this constellation of spirits connects the present to the past in a co-construction of spiritual life histories for the living and the dead. In voices that are doubled and quoted, the participants in the Misa show us that the dead are watching, listening, and asking us to engage with the past in visceral and real ways. The revelatory narrative process of the Misa reaffirms relationships, conflicts, warnings, powers, and work yet to be done with spirit guides and the worlds they represent. Here the ontology of coexistence pushes past the boundaries of the binaries of self and other,
body and spirit, and into the dense compilations of associations that emphasize spiritual movement, negotiation, and creativity. And Raquel Romberg, in her work in Espiritismo in Puerto Rico, sees some of the work that people, the way that people mix ethnic associations in Espiritismo as creolization with an attitude. So I like that. So I also want to, I'll conclude now because I know we don't have that much time. I want to conclude with a quote from Munoz as well. And he said in Disidentifications, that seminal book, quote, it is my contention that the doing that matters most and the performance that seems most crucial are nothing short of the actual making of worlds. The Mises spirit guides that briefly appear may contain the same kind of repertoires of ephemerally coded performances that can and cannot be read from the official archives of history. Here, of course, I'm talking from Diana Taylor's work. The tensions inherent in binding the folk Catholic, Palo, Santeria, and Espiritista traditions together in the image of creolized passing spirits signal to gendered race, sex, and ethnic hauntings that the memory of colonization, transnational immigration, and transculturation in contemporary Cuba engenders. The labor or trabajo, and it is called spiritual work, trabajo, that the spirits come down to do in the misa and in the tierra is also organized in a manner that suggests the kinds of work that especially people of color, women, and sexual minorities have done and continue to do spiritually and sexually with their bodies in Latin America in terms of producing certain goods, results, and experiences for others. As with the voices in Taylor's archive, some missing, some whispering, some resounding, the voices that come together in the misa give us a guide as to how to read what is left of a partial story based on a phenomenological continuum of experiences.
And that's it. Thank you. And we'll have time for question and discussions at the end. Okay, the second presenter is Carolina Caballero. Carolina received her PhD in Romance Languages from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Inspired by her experience growing up in a Cuban family in the U.S., Carolina explored the performance of exile in drama of the Cuban diaspora in her dissertation. Her other research interests include manifestations of violence and gender construction and deconstruction in Cuban, Cuban diasporic, and U.S. Latino, Latina drama and narrative. She has published articles and essays on Cuban diasporic theater and performance in several journals. Since 2008, she teaches at Tulane University in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese, and she's currently Associate Director of the Cuban and Caribbean Studies Institute at Tulane. Her presentation today is titled Orphaned, Coming of Age in Blind Mouth Singing and Bird in the Hand by Jorge Ignacio Cortiñas.
Good morning. I think I have to lift this up a little bit. Can y'all hear me? Yeah? Kind of?
Un poquito más cerca.
Like?
Yeah, just lift it.
Yeah, you're there.
Okay. Now? Yes? Okay. I want to thank Eric for asking me to participate in this panel and tell you guys a little bit about how I came upon this, well, how I decided to write about Jorge Ignacio Cortiñas. Last spring, I had the pleasure of seeing Bird in Hand, which is one of the texts I will be talking about, that Jorge directed in New York City. And I remember sitting there, the theater was packed, and I went with a Cuban, I would consider him a Cuban exile author, Pedro Monge Raffles was with me, and it was fascinating how, and it was a very diverse group that was there, and although the play takes place in Miami, and it's about Cuban-American, and the characters are Cuban, and most of the main characters are Cuban-American, that wasn't what connected me necessarily as a Cuban-American with the play. It was the sentiments, it was the emotions that they were projecting, right? It wasn't my connection with the identity, cultural connection with the characters, but it was the emotions. So when I saw the description for this panel, how is art marked by diaspora and its dramaturgy, affective practice, and emotive patina? I thought, this might be my chance to explore a little bit how I connected with Cortiñas and how everybody in the public connected with this play by Cortiñas. So, and also I kind of changed the title. I just put Imagining Diasporas instead of Orphaned, although being orphaned plays a small part in this paper. Cuban-American and Latino playwright Jorge Ignacio Cortiñas imagines diaspora through unrooted characters who yearn for mobility in blind mouth singing and bird in hand. The protagonist, Rey de Rico and Felix, are disaffected young men coming of age, strange to those around them and estranged even to themselves. Alienated rebels with a cause. Their cause? Placement, but on their terms. Their mission? Comprehension and rootedness. Their chance of success? It's never made completely clear. What is apparent is that in these plays, Cortiñas succeeds in appealing to a wide range of audiences, while at the same time dialoguing specifically with the Caribbean, Latin American, Latino context. And this is where I think I'm trying to go, and I'm sure I'll be able to tease out a little bit more. And I believe he does this by stripping diaspora of ideology and nationality and presenting it through basic elements and emotions. And these basic elements and emotions that we will see in both plays is the idea of movement, rootlessness, and desire. And rootlessness, I use rootlessness and unroot, which is different from uproot, and unroot doesn't appear, it doesn't exist as a word necessarily, but as in not having roots at all, while uproot is pulling them up, but rootlessness. And here I'm going to talk a little bit about José Esteban Muñoz as well, because José Esteban Muñoz also talks about the way Cortiñas manages to connect emotionally with the spectator. And he does this in his article. The article is called El Imposible Encubrimiento de la Cubanía. José Esteban Muñoz focuses on Cortiñas' proclivity for writing, and I quote, obras sobre sentimientos, so text about feelings, sentiment. For Muñoz, Cortiñas expresses what he calls Latinidad in a globalized context, as an essence instead of an identity. And he describes it in this way, Latinidad as una manera de ser en el mundo, and also, and perhaps more importantly, una forma de sentir en el mundo. So Latinness as a way of being in the world and as a way of feeling in the world. Muñoz further argues that the theatrical worlds that Cortiñas creates and the motives that drive his characters are not always evident, but that he uses, and I quote, la imprecisión para complotar la pertinencia afectiva que une las vivencias de varios pueblos interpelados por las coordenadas de la llamada Latinidad. Close quote. In this way, in Cortiñas' plays, the characters, and I quote again from Muñoz, nos hablan en un tono que alcanza nuestra experiencia interior, nuestro entendimiento, que interpela directamente a los espectadores. So when I'm speaking specifically of these two texts, Blind Mouth Singing and Bird in Hand, there is little doubt that his Latinidad and obviously his Cubanía influenced Cortiñas. Blind Mouth Singing takes place in a tropical island space prone to hurricanes, while Bird in Hand occurs in Miami, Florida, with self-identified Cuban-American characters. Yet contrary to Muñoz's emphasis on his expression of Latinidad, and he talks about how him as a man of color and as a Cuban man, how he talks to him in that sense, I assert that what Cortiñas communicates goes beyond any specific geographic and national identity markers, precisely because these plays deal with, and another quote from Muñoz, el ser y el sentimiento de existir, el sentir en el ser. So again, it's the fact that Cortiñas focuses on sentiment, on being, instead of on Cubanness or Latinidad, in my estimation, is what makes these what is what he's doing with diaspora, right? He's universalizing diaspora. For that reason, I believe that in these texts, the playwright develops and creates a diasporic art, as defined by Ileana Rivero, because they are based on, and I quote, vivencias nutridas en raíces fundacionales, pero que se proyectan hacia un futuro pluralista. So he goes from the local to the general, to local to the universal. Inasmuch as the sentiments displayed by Federico and Felix ring true for some people more than others, I argue that the characters perform their diasporic condition as a phenomenon no longer contained in specific groups, but as a globalized experience, shared through universal sentiments easily recognizable by most people. And so now I kind of want to go through how how in both plays these protagonists actually perform diaspora in the same way, and how the playwright uses probably the same themes, the same structures, the same performative elements to present this diasporic condition. As a defining element of identity, rootedness, the world over, but particularly in Latin American cultures, the unified family as refuge and haven suffers greatly in Blind Mouth Singing and Bird in Hand. Both Federico and Felix are orphaned in a sense, displaced and out of sync with their kin. They seek the opportunity to break these conventional bloodlines that keep them artificially tied. Resigned to a bitter and stagnant existence, mother of the late afternoon, and this is Federico's, the name of Federico's mother, the character's name, in Blind Mouth Singing, keeps her sons in a line in a stern and regimented household. Cortinas introduces this character by stating she, and I quote, is sharpening kitchen knives. This is a kitchen full of knives. In another scene, while Federico attempts to speak to her, she uses these knives to cut off the head off squabs, letting them hang to bleed out onto the floor. Similarly, she has castrated Federico and her older brother, requiring them to stay close to home. Gordy, Federico's older brother, has also made this home inhospitable for his brother. In Gordy's quest to become a man through drink, smoke, and violence, he doesn't understand or accept his brother, who is, and I quote, good with words, end quote, and makes up stories and stares endlessly into the bottom of the well in the garden. He tells Federico, and I quote, you do things, Ray. Just the way you talk, it offends us. Just the way you talk, it insults us. Why do you act like that? Close quote. While Federico struggles to find his footing in the toxic family environment, Cortinas emphasizes Felix's rootlessness through the fact that his family never appears on stage. Bird in Hand revolves around the protagonist who works at a theme park, and the name of the theme park is Birdland Family Theme Park, owned and operated by his father. Felix's relationship with his father is tenuous at best. While Felix is extremely intelligent and almost perfect score on his SAT, and will most likely end up at an Ivy League university in the fall, we surmise that his father remains unimpressed. After his best friend Gabriel tells him that he cannot hang out because he cannot hang out on Friday night because he has a date with his girlfriend, Felix responds, and I quote, I guess I'll spend Friday night at home so my Cuban dad can stare at me and wonder why his only son is bad at sports and has no friends. Awesome. Close quote. It is not until Felix has sex with Susan, which is Gabriel's girlfriend, that he gets his father's attention. Instead of his father being disappointed in him for sleeping with his best friend's girlfriend, his dad just looks him up and down and I quote, his hands stuffed under his belt the way he does, close quote, and tells him that he, quote, was finally developing a head for business, close quote, and ask him to join the park's management. So in essence, Felix's only close relationship is with Gabriel. Unlike Felix, Gabriel struggles academically, is not sure if he's going to college, and this all takes place basically like the spring semester of their senior year in high school. In several scenes, Felix helps Gabriel study for the verbal section, and it's interesting, like Federico, Felix is also good at words. Gabriel is really the opposite of Felix. He is well-adjusted, dates, and seems to have a good relationship with his extended Cuban family and the city of Miami. Gabriel often defends his hometown against Felix's negativity. And I quote from the play, Gabriel, this town is where we're from, where we have roots. Felix, newsflash, Florida is 50% landfill. You can't have roots in landfill. Close quote. It is in Gabriel only that Felix combines his revolutionary plan, and he calls it revolutionary, of freeing the flamingos that are in the park so they can return home to Cuba. The principal tour guide of the flamingo exhibit in the park, Felix stopped clipping the birds' wings and has given them flying lessons. And this is a conversation when he reveals this plan to Felix. I have this theory this town is killing that bird, Gabriel. My grandmother is the same way. She's always like, I cry every day I have to speak the English. Felix, except I'm calling that bird's bluff. Let's see if he has the balls to stop complaining and actually take off. Gabriel, answer my question. What do you think the odds are that this lonely flamingo actually takes off? Felix, I've been throwing in flying lessons. I figured the bird has motivation. Gabriel, you really think that flamingo is going to fly away? Felix, not up to me. It's up to the bird. Gabriel, I bet you it stays here. Why would anybody leave? Felix, I bet you it gets the hell out. Obviously, Felix's attempt to liberate the flamingos from captivity is a metaphor for his desire. ¿Cuánto? One? is a metaphor for his desire to fly away, migrate, escape as well. Okay, so in 60 seconds. So this continues. So this unrootedness is also displayed in these characters, their displacement. They're actually desdoblado. They're split on stage, right? Federico has a double on stage, Lucero. So he's split in two. While Felix also, he's narrating. Like, so the play is actually looking at him, him looking at the past, looking at this summer several years later. And while, even though it's his words, the other characters are speaking for him. It's the other characters that are saying it. So we see this kind of unrootedness in that way, the lack of comfortableness in their own skin. And then they both attempt to leave. But what's interesting about their flight and they see all this opportunity and this chance somewhere else is that they both end up coming back for several reasons. And it's very sad in a way, and very kind of melancholic and nostalgic. And this is probably a good thing because my conclusion is, because I was like, in my conclusion, I'm not really sure, but this is what I have. And so, denied its traditional ideological and national ties, the diasporic condition performed in these texts is imbued with emotions that can be, and I quote, experienced by anyone, anywhere. It intrigues me that both Lucero and Felix come full circle, back to where they started, back to their early selves. Their radical wanderings only serve to crystallize their rootlessness, marked by loneliness and longing. That is what makes these texts so poignant. Their power lies not in their discernible markings of Latinidad or Cubanía, but in the feelings their search elicits in all of us. And I think that's his diasporic imaginings, right? Going from the local, his diasporicness, to communicating it to the universal, to all of us in that way. So thank you very much.
So I am the, can you hear me? It's okay? You can hear me? All right. So I'm the third speaker. It's kind of odd to introduce myself, so I'm just going to say a few words. Lillian Manzor, I'm associate professor in modern languages and literatures at the University of Miami, and I'm founding director of the Cuban Theater Digital Archive, which in its first version was the Cuban Latino Theater Archive, and by the way, the first two conferences of NoPassport, NoPassport 1, NoPassport 2, are archived there. I publish on Cuban American, Caribbean diasporic work. Eric has in here that the volume Latinas on Stage, which I co-edited with Alicia Rizón, it says it was one of the definitive volumes creating the field of the study of Latino theater and performance, which, yes. I think it's true.
Yes.
And I will leave it at that. I will be talking today, the title of my presentation is Digital Archives and Interconnected Diasporas, Anna in the Tropics. I'm going to start with a quote from Stuart Hall. They bear upon them the traces of the particular cultures, traditions, languages, and histories by which they were shaped. The difference is that they are not and will never be unified in the old sense because they are irrevocably the product of several interlocking histories and cultures belong at one and the same time to several homes. End of quote. And there has been quite a bit of debate as to whether the concept of diaspora is applicable to the Cuban case. And this debate comes, especially from sociologists and political scientists who believe that categories such as exile and migration are better apt to approach Cuba and that diaspora is not really conceptually or theoretically an applicable concept or construct. Rather than entering into this debate, my starting point for this presentation is the assumption that Cuban cultural expressions from the very beginning operated within a diasporic space that crossed and questioned national boundaries. Thus, whether we look at Gertrudis Gomez de Avellaneda in the 19th century, and I say Gertrudis because everybody's celebrating the the anniversary this year, or the contemporary work of U.S.-Cuban playwrights such as Jorge Ignacio Cortiñas, that Carolina has talked about, Caridad Svich, and Nilo Cruz, we realize that their theater performs the very fact that, and I quote, you can live in a place without totally or solely subscribing to the national heritage or dominant national discourse of that place. And this creates a space for both conflict and creativity, end quote. In this presentation, I will focus specifically on the space that digital initiatives offer for bridging Cuban diasporic communities, taking the Havana-Miami theatrical production of Anna in the Tropics as a case example. Although the focus of this presentation is Cuban diasporic cultural sensitivity, I need to briefly address the place from which we're working. To situate our work on and with Cuba from Miami, one has to understand that in order to work with Cuba, one has to navigate two bureaucracies that are at odds with each other, actually that are enemies. This is the result of a series of sanctions imposed in the midst of the Cold War, a Cold War that, of course, is supposed to have ended. However, the U.S. economic embargo towards Cuba and the continued policy of isolation towards the island is a relic of the Cold War in our midst. In the Miami-Havana border zone, a real and conceptual space in which acts of real and symbolic violence continue to be perpetrated, this complex political scenario is worsened because Miami in general and the University of Miami in particular tends to be associated with the politics of aggression, isolation, and disengagement that is characteristic of the older and more affluent sector of the Cuban exile community. Havana, by the same token, not by the same token, but on the other hand, tends to homogenize Miami and characterize Miami and its inhabitants as the home of, quote unquote, the uncultured Cuban mafia. I have started with these brief sociopolitical remarks, to underscore that our cultural work is not divorced from the study of other institutional forms, and I quote, from the mundane discourses of bureaucracies, armies, private corporations, and not non-state social organizations, end of quote. So the first Cuban Theater Digital Archive, it's an interactive World Wide Web research site for Cuban theater and performing arts. It was developed in order to address the documentation challenges artists and scholars face vis-a-vis the writing of a theater history that takes into account live performance. It is conceived as a research, teaching, and learning program that integrates classroom education and community engagement in Cuban theater, new media, art, and archival primary research with an online scholarly publishing effort that provides a unique view of contemporary Cuban culture. This digital cultural heritage initiative focuses in its initial phase on the works, both written text and live art performance, of theater practitioners in Greater Cuba, that is, on the island and in the diaspora. And I use Ana Lopez's construct of Greater Cuba to suggest that border zone in which citizenship is reformulated as a result of the encounter between competing national jurisdictions and the global economy. The archive is managed as a digital humanities partnership between the University of Miami College of Arts and Sciences and the libraries in cooperation with Cuba's National Council for the Performing Arts and also in Cuba, the Center for Stage Design Studies. As a community archive, it works closely with playwrights and theater artists, regardless of their place of residence, in order to document, preserve, and offer access collaboratively to artists' archives. And it has been funded in part by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. So, in spite of the sociopolitical and cultural divide that exists between the different Cuban communities in the U.S. and in Cuba, CTDA, the archive, is a virtual space where artists coexist, regardless of self-identification or political inclinations. And I'm just going to show you a few samples of some of the materials of the artists that we have to give you a sense of the varying range of diasporas that are represented in the archive. So first one is Hector Santiago, the materials of Hector Santiago. Hector Santiago is a playwright and choreographer who was actually formed in the early revolutionary period, was very active in founding the children's movement in Cuba, and by the end of the 60s was persecuted for being a homosexual. His work was banned. He disappeared from Cuban, I mean, the island cultural realm, left Cuba in 1979 and has been working in New York since the late 80s. And we, have his materials in there. He would consider himself an exile writer. And there are several, there's a whole constellation of writers such as him. We also have... include the works of people like Manuel Martin Jr. Manuel Martin Jr. left Cuba in the early 50s, not for political reasons. He went to New York to study acting. He was instrumental forging the off-Broadway theater movement in New York, especially the off-Broadway theater movement in Spanish. Went on to found Teatro Duo Theater, which is one of the earlier Spanish theater groups in New York. And so we have, like Manuel Martin, kind of an early diasporic subject, a whole range of materials from artists similar to Manuel Martin. We also have, incorporate the works of writers like Abel González Melo. These are Cuban artists that left Cuba since the mid-90s and have been able to kind of live and work in dual places. González Melo is between Havana and Madrid. We have artists that are between Mexico and Cuba. So these are artists of, kind of dual citizenship. Whose work is also, not just because of the dual citizenship, but whose work also, falls within contemporary diasporic consciousness. And then we have the work of artists like Caridad Svich, Eduardo Machado, Luis Santeiro, even Jorge Ignacio Cortiñas. And these are artists who are part of the U.S. theater scene, artists whose work is primarily in English, but who have also worked in Spanish, artists with, a clear diasporic consciousness. And this is the page of Caridad Svich. I guess it's the first page of the materials that are visual, like photographic materials. The archive includes photographs as well as filmed theatrical productions. As a matter of fact, the Blind Mouth thing, the Havana production of Blind Mouth Singing that Carolina was talking about for the Havana production is coming up in a few weeks. Right. At any rate, so the quick sampling of selected materials of Cuban theater artists gives us an idea of the complexity encountered when dealing with diasporic consciousness in Cuban theater. Although theoretically, like all of the materials that I've showed you, could be considered diasporic, some of the writers do not self-identify as diasporic artists. Others reside in Cuba and actually have a diasporic consciousness. I think what's interesting is that overall, theater artists have been, active and interested in including the materials in the digital archive because, as Salvador Lemis, who is a Cuban-Mexican artist, has stated, and he says, the archive makes sure, and I quote, that things do not get lost in the shipwreck of our condition, which I think it's a beautiful phrase for what, we're actually trying to do. So the archive also co-sponsors theatrical co-productions that are based on intercultural exchanges, and we focus primarily in Miami and Havana because doing co-productions kind of outside of Miami with Cuba, it's always difficult, but it's much easier than working from Miami. And Ana in the Tropics, in Spanish, Ana en el Trópico, is one of the latest co-productions that we've sponsored. The project involved bringing together actors from Miami and Havana to stage a Spanish version of Nilo Cruz's Pulitzer Anne in the Tropics. It was directed by one of Cuba's most important and daring directors, Carlos Diaz, from Teatro El Público. The first step was a new translation from English to Spanish by James Lopez, who is, I mean, a translator, professor in South Florida, but actually the grandson of an Ybor City cigar worker. So the Spanish translation, in a way, you know, we wanted, without changing Nilo's words, of course, to be, in a way, kind of infused by the language of the late 19th century, early 20th century Spanish, spoken by the Ybor City cigar workers. So part of the cast, the director, and the dramaturg went to Miami in June, and they worked with the three Cuban actors residing in Miami. We went to Ybor City and workshopped the first draft of the translation in June 2013. The director then worked with three of the actors from Miami during the month of July at the university, and he also worked with other members of the theater group with whom he worked that, you know, have been dispersed in Spain, in Mexico, etc. So the three main actors were from Miami, but other actors participated in the stage reading and the rehearsals. And this is the director and one of the actors. The director then returned to Cuba and worked with the rest of the cast in August and September, and then the Miami actors traveled to Cuba in October, where they worked for 3 weeks, the whole cast now, and the play had a pre-opening for 3 days to sold-out audiences, first at the Trianon, and then it came to Miami in November for a three-night run at the Colony Theater. So just a few notes on Anna in the Tropics and the Diasporic Imagination and the production of Anna en el Trópico. The play script itself, as you probably know, presents the story of Cuban cigar workers in Ybor City as they recreate their trade, traditions, and the island they left behind, all under the threat of industrialization. A family brings from Havana to Tampa a new lector, a new reader, and as he reads Anna Karenina to the workers, the novel impacts and intertwines with the characters' lives, so that slowly Anna, the novel, and the character takes over the action, only to be transformed in turn into a haunting evocation of love. And I have a whole section that I'm not going to talk about here about longing, sexuality, sensuality, and a set of, I mean, triangles in Anna in the Tropics, and Nilo Cruz's Anna, which I'm going to skip. Now, Carlos Diaz, the director's Anna en el Trópico, so the stage production, adds several layers to Cruz's diasporic consciousness. First of all, the staging, without changing the text at all, underscored the uncanny parallelisms between these early 20th century diasporic subjects in Tampa and contemporary Cuban diaspora. Secondly, Carlos Diaz conceived of the staging as an homage to Roberto Blanco, one of the most important Cuban theater directors who left Cuba for Venezuela in 1993 at the height of the special period, and then, I mean, he died in 2003. 1993 marks also the same time when the main actresses, Lili Renteria and Mabel Roche, left for Venezuela and Miami, respectively. So Lili Renteria is to the left and Mabel to the right. So Roberto Blanco was Carlos Diaz's first mentor, and it was one of the of Lili Renteria's director. And both Lili Renteria and Mabel Roche, the actresses, had not been on the Cuban stages since 1993. So there was quite a bit of expectation in Cuba from the audience of, it was kind of like the return of these actresses that had been absent from the Cuban stages. So Carlos Diaz's staging intertextually connected Cruz's verbal texts with Blanco's productions and also Cuban contemporary Cuban theater, so that even Cruz's canary, if you remember, the section in Anna in the Tropics about the canary, and the white gardenias that the female characters wear at the beginning of the play uncannily resonate with Roberto Blanco's Yellow Canary line and Raquel Revuelta's famous line in Lucia, una gardenia, mamá, una gardenia. And these, I mean, it was just, I mean, uncanny connections between Nilo Cruz and the staging that Carlos Diaz has did. Ultimately, Renteria's acting style and Diaz's visual stage composition was reminiscent of Roberto Blanco's style and approach, both unavailable to contemporary Cubans on either side of the Florida streets. And I'm just going to show you a few images and conclude. This is a section from the play when they're discussing and kind of deciding to vote on whether the lector is going to stay or go. Carlos Diaz staged it almost like a kind of a 4th of July celebration. And this humongous American flag came up, which in Cuba, as you can imagine, was like, you know, that you could hear the sigh of the audience. These are, another stage. This is, an image from the end when the lector, Juan Julian, dies and then snows kind of falls and the applause. So to conclude, despite the challenge of U.S.-Cuba relations, the co-production of Anne en el Trópico created a space that brought together early 20th century Cuban diaspora in Tampa and late 20th century Cuban diaspora from many places. Through theater, we were able to finally take Nilo Cruz, as well as return Lily Renteria and Mabel Rush to the Cuban stages. The Cuban Theater Digital Archive and its goal of preserving and providing access to evanescent performance materials fosters scholarly communication between different communities and helps create the space for theatrical co-productions such as Ana en el Trópico, in which cooperation and common artistic goals brings us together outside of the Cold War rhetoric that continues to guide U.S.-Cuba relations on both sides of the Florida Straits. In both virtual and real physical ways, we're able to transcend the political. Thus, the diasporic imagination continues to draw a map of greater Cuba that goes beyond the national and is firmly anchored, or perhaps poetically anchored, in the theatrical. Thank you. Are you going to present, or should I? Okay, so just a couple of minutes to set up the performances that follow, and then I'll introduce the performances.
Okay, so I'm going to take over moderating for our two performances. Sort of in the spirit of No Passport, we're going to put scholarship with performance directly. My introduction, it's in the packets, so you can look it over. I studied Cuban theater in the U.S., especially Cuban avant-garde theater between Miami, Havana, and New York. But it's my pleasure now to introduce Margaret Kemp and talk about her work a little bit in respect to the diasporic imagination. Margaret Kemp is a performance artist who currently has an appointment at LSU in the Department of Theater, and whose work I have been lucky enough to get to know over the past academic year. Kemp's performance, Confluence, formerly entitled A Negro Speaks of Rivers, offers several glimpses into how the diasporic imagination manifests itself in theater and performance and addresses some key questions of this relationship. Diaspora is one model for understanding how a population with a common origin or homeland spreads across the globe through migration, forced and voluntary. Kemp's Confluence complicates this notion in looking at both the intersection of multiple diasporas and the diaspora of the diaspora as the second generation of diasporic populations, the children of immigrants, continue to spread and move to other regions. An autobiographical performance, Confluence, deals with multiple diasporas of Kemp's own family, whose mother immigrated to the United States from Panama and whose father came to the U.S. from the Bahamas. Diasporic populations, as Kemp's work reminds us, even for herself as a second-generation Bahamian-American and Panamanian-American, carry homeland memory and displacement with them and how they make sense of themselves and the world around them. Often, a harsh world that marginalizes their voice and culture and subordinates them as foreign immigrants and racial others. Regarding imagination and theater, I am drawn to think first of Benedict Anderson and Homi Bhabha's work in thinking about how diasporic communities, or nations in the case of Anderson, imagine themselves in theater and performance. For Anderson, when he's talking about print culture especially, and national imaginaries, all nations are imagined political communities because no one can know every other person in a nation face to face. Therefore, quote, yet in the minds of each citizen, lives the image of their communion, end quote. Homi Bhabha critiques Anderson's imaginaries that are ordered by a homogeneous modernity and Eurocentric concept of nation, explaining that subaltern experiences and voices emerge betwixt and between times and places. To rupture modernity and the false solidarity of the imaginary from alternative time spaces, Kemp's work imagines in such ruptures in between, betwixt, as Bhabha explains, quote, betwixt and between times and places. And as she imagines from these ruptures, with the ruptures which is understood by their radical historicity embodied by the actor in performance, where diaspora is imagined before the audience through a living presence of the actor. Confluence tells the story of the internal life of Kemp in separate moments as she prepares for her father to visit her in her home in Los Angeles. In multiple detours of stream of consciousness, Kemp's narrative interrupts a progressive linear structure. The detours take place when her father's voice on the phone of a long-distance call becomes a meditation on the strains of long distance and displacement on family bonds and relationships. Or when she's driving to the airport to pick up her father, the city's many highways tell the story of colonization as their flows are associated with the underground flows of the paved over LA River, covering over the hidden history of colonization beneath, an oppressive history whose colonial power relationships of race and gender are not unlike those that split Kemp's family apart. And it's this river beneath the surface that Kemp wishes to uncover, recover, and submerge the audience in. Throughout the many detours leading to Kemp's reconnection with her father, the audience hears the story of her father's migration to the United States, where he is racialized differently in different regions of the U.S., finally ending up in Boston, where he's labeled as Negro in the 1940s. Kemp's youth, growing up in a pan-Caribbean neighborhood in Dudley Square, Boston, Massachusetts, and the systematic racism and xenophobic isolation of that neighborhood that brings about its destruction through poverty, lack of public services, gentrification development schemes, are part of this story, a part of what she uncovers. And these systematized racisms and violence in this Dudley Square neighborhood make it a place plagued by violence and which eventually leads to the traumatic splitting apart of her family. So Kemp also brings into her work seguiría, or flamenco singing, which I think is another interesting thing. When she was working with Mariela Chiari Aragon in Los Angeles, she was a Panamanian folk singer, or she had she directed Kemp, who wished to include that into her work, to learn seguiría, because it was probably the closest thing to that style of folk singing. So here, it's really interesting in thinking about the diasporic imagination, how Kemp takes this other tradition and transplants it into her aesthetic as a way to fill the absence that her mother has left, or that is left by the missing presence of her mother, and that she holds these deep and watery memories of her mother singing to her, but the break and the displacement is and the rift in memory is too much. So the siguiría comes in place to fill the void there. But in addition to that, sort of as a learning Spanish as a second language, that there's a distance that she incorporates, not just in the way she pronounces the Spanish in the siguirías that she sings, but also in how she chooses to translate the lyrics that she's written first in English, making choices that are strange. And for this reason, you know, to to express that estrangement that she has and that distance. So without further ado, I'm we'll go ahead and let Margaret show you an excerpt of Confluence that she's prepared just for this conference.
I live in the future. I buried my treasures. Hear it? Is about 70% water. And water has perfect memory. It's forever trying to reclaim the valley it runs through, the banks there were, its original place. Beneath the river, time stretches like breath. There was a neighborhood where on Indian summer nights you might hear singing sometimes. Mi niña estará bien. Ella a la universidad y todo estará bien. What are you doing? Sleeping on the couch. To bed, to bed. You can't go to university if you can't wake up for fifth grade. What's that in your pocket? A penny? Three small stones. A dream? And a stick of juicy fruit. Pajamas. Prayers. Story. Once, in past time, past the time that we call then, it rained and rained and rained until it rained for 300 million years. And in the midst of that rain grew an island of trees and that grew as thick as families. And there was a river that flowed through the island. And a lovely maiden who liked to sit on the bank of a river. But she didn't know that she was sitting on twisted and confused wet roots filled with all sorts of floating, growing, collecting, and seeds. And so she sat on her riverbank until she fell asleep. And then one night, she heard bump, bump, heartbeat from beneath the river. Oh, she covered her ears and she moved her body, but still, bump, bump, heartbeat. Finally, she opened her eyes. And what a sight she saw. Splish, splash, the water lapped like feet were pressing their soles to break out of the river. She reached out to rescue the invisible body, and just then, tree roots and fingers became fingers and snatched her into the river. As she fought the bump, bump, heartbeat, she reached back for the grass, and it vanished into the earth. She reached into the earth, and it vanished into her flesh. She called into far away for her mother, and only the river answered, Rechinaba! Rechinaba!
Vapor breath fills the room. Mom talks in English, but her secrets are in Spanish. Her secrets are in her singing. I like the sounds.
But no, 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 teaching this little girl Spanish,
Daddy says.
My mother used to sing. Nada for fortaleza. Swim for strength. Bailo con huesos de barro. Dance with the clay bones. And whenever it rains for months, or rains and rains for weeks, I think of her. Thank
you. Okay, just another minute for Omni, Zona, Franca to set up their projections.
Great entrance.
Okay, the next performance coming up is by Luis Eligio de Omni and Kizzy Macias of Omni, Zona, Franca. These are a performance excerpt. Omni, Zona, Franca is a multidisciplinary collective from Cuba. Omni Zona Franca is known for its work with unconventional methods. Theater Omni's work is a unique blend of performance, music, poetry, spoken word, rap, visual art, graffiti, video, and public art. Working together since 1997, they have produced several music, poetry CDs and videos, including the groundbreaking CD Alamar Express. They produce an annual music, art, theater, and poetry festival, Poesía Sin Fin, in Cuba. They have taken part in the Havana Biennial and international exhibitions and festivals throughout Cuba and Europe. Omni has been recipient of many residencies, including Art Residency AIR, Laboratory Center for Contemporary Art, Ujadowski Castle, Warsaw, and Art Residency AS220 at La Mama Experimental Theater, Brown University, and Art Residency at Glasshouse Gallery, Williamsburg, New York.
El llanto es por amor, este canto es por amor. En la distancia te nombro, patria, alma, vivo en ti con dolor. Tu silencio llega al fondo. Rompe miedo, mar, isla que te ahogas en tu propio mar. Y me miras.
Oh, yo, ni yo. Ay, ay, mi human, yo qué. Ni yo, ni yo, ni yo. Ay, ay, mi human, yo qué. Ni yo, ni yo, ni yo. Ay, ay, mi human, yo qué. Ni yo, ni yo, ni yo. Ay, ay, mi human, yo qué. New York, concreto, mole, cáncer artificial de la naturaleza. Gente conectada al dinero y adictos a la velocidad. Venimos a New York para permitirnos conocer el estado de las almas. En New York. Qué bello horror, neón, autos, máquinas, gentes, máquinas, más autos que gente, gente más metalizada que los autos. New York, estatua, solo eso, estatua, el mundo es New York. Llegamos a New York, llegamos a la libertad. En New York somos más libres de la isla, país, Alcatraz, Istmo, Desesperanza, Cuba. Amamos los cantos de libertad. Woodman por Street Job, Martín mujer descalza, apóstol muerto en Central Park, Chisbel Park en Isla Habana, Waddle, Isla Miami, Isla Willy Canta, Isla Celia, Mágica Cruz, Isla Dolé, Madison Square, Isla Mirta, Linares, Ilusión, Divas, Isat, Miravalle, Sotero, Cristi, Isla Pavón, Isla Bouzá, Isla People, Isla Orisha, Yerbabuena, Isla Arenas, Isla Todos, bajando por New York, New York, New York, New York. Soñando todo, yo en New York, yo sueño en New York. New York, New York, New York. I am human, yo qué. New York, New York, New York. I am human, yo qué. New York, New York, New York. I am human, yo qué. New York, New York, New York. I am human, yo qué. Yes! Come on! Come on! Come on! Come on! Cuban kisser my life! Cuban kisser my life! Cuban kisser my life! Cuban kisser my! Cuban kisser my life! This is Santa New York, Havana speed of life! High blood, white, white! My baby, I don't know why I cry. That woman for you. Lucy. Soon, sorry for saying you for me. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you, liberty, my eye, I love you. I love you, liberty, my eye, I love you.
Sing it, dance it, sing it.
Thinking, begging, liberation, 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 a power, a power, a power. Touch on peace, champion in your heart, boom, tra, boom, in your heart, tra, boom. Dia, vida, ay, life, try. Drink it, celestial, dia, ay, dia. Out of machine, cocaine, cocaine, a natural thing. Liberty, please, liberty, she, I. We are in
liberation,
liberation, liberation, liberation, pra pra cum, pra cum, pra 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 sum. Sol, oh, say you for me.
I love you, I love you, I love you.
In this song, I speak about my country, Cuba. Cuba is the woman. I love you, liberty, my, I love you. Singing, dancing, thinking, searching, liberation, 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 liberation. Liberation! 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 Liberation!
Liberation!
Big thanks to Omni Zona Franca, Kizzy and Louis. And we're going to segue straight into the next panel in the world of conferences. Things happen, which is apt segue. It's jazz in plays. And this is also an